Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
So Father, we come before you. Lord, we just acknowledge the fact that we have such a privilege to be here in the house of God tonight. Lord, there are those around the world that are dying and literally facing immense persecution just to read a page of your word. And here we are tonight, Lord, free of persecution, without fear, to worship you and to draw close to you. And Lord, we thank you for that, the blessings that you've given to us. God, we don't come into this place to hear from a man or to hear from a woman. Lord, we don't come to hear from the old or from the young or anything like that. God, we come into this place to hear from you. We don't come to church for tradition or ritual's sake, but we come into this place fully expecting to hear the word of God. And we acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this house. So it's in the name of Jesus we ask that your precious Holy Spirit would be our counselor tonight, would be our guidance, would teach us and show us and remind us of things that we've already learned in this word tonight. Lord, we thank you that as we do, your word would be like a seed planted into good and fertile ground, that fertile ground being our hearts and our lives open and prepared to receive your word, that as we leave this place, this building, that God, we would bear much fruit for the kingdom and for the glory of God, and we would reflect your glory through being the church. Father, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. We don't ever think of ourselves as better or higher than anybody else here at the Rock Church, but we are co-laborers in the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Lord, we thank you that you would bless our brothers and sisters across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that you would bless our Catholic and Adventist brothers and sisters. Lord, we thank you for our denominational brothers and sisters, Lutherans, Episcopalians, Baptists, Presbyterians, Methodists. Lord, we thank you for all of the denominations, Foursquare. Lord, we lift up our fellow brothers and sisters around the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel tonight and all throughout the week, Harvest, The Grove, Sandals. Lord, we lift up The Well and The Way. Lord, we lift up Water of Life and Emmanuel Baptist. God, we ask that your hand would be upon Trinity and Victory, Lord, Abundant Living and Oak Valley and all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. And Lord, we thank you that we are all brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, working to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Lord, to you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray, Lord, that your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
Amen.
Amen. Well, I tell you, tonight is a good word. It's a night for me. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of 2 Corinthians in the 9th chapter. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Really neat section of scripture, and before we get into it, and before I even give you the title of tonight's message, I want to tell you a story, something that happened to me, kind of a confession, if you will. 2 Corinthians in the 9th chapter, and I'm going to tell you a story as you turn there. I was, a few months ago now, I was right here at the gas station on the corner of Waterman Avenue and Redlands Boulevard. Now, this gas station right here on the corner, if you've ever been there, is notorious. It's like, without fail, every time I get gas, there's somebody that just beelines it to my car and gives me some story. I'm driving and I'm from out of town and I only have 3 more miles to go and I ran out of gas. Could you just give me $10 to get to where I need to go? And without fail, to the point where I've made it a point to just begin avoiding that gas station altogether, because I've given in to those a couple of times, and I remember one time one of our pastors, Pastor Joe, he's not here so I can tell on him, somebody gave him the story, and he said he needed a bus ticket, and he needed like $30 for a bus ticket, and Pastor Joe gave him 30 bucks, and was like, here man, here's your bus ticket, go get it, and the guy walked like 12 feet to the next person, and was like, hey man, I need a bus ticket, it's 30 bucks, and Pastor Joe just had this righteous anger that rose up. He went over to that guy. I was like, hey man, I gave you the money. What are you? And we found out, you know, that was a story that he was using or whatever it would be. No, I'm not going to get into the politics of whether or not somebody's asking for money is true or not. Simply put, that gas station has a reputation. So I was getting gas there and I was sitting there and I was getting out and I saw a young guy, real young. He was walking around. You could tell when they're not getting gas, that there's an ulterior motive, right? So I get out, just kind of keep my head down, okay? Put my gas, you know, my fuel line in there. Right as I start pumping gas, this big, and I don't want to get cliche, but this big Ford old SUV shows up with all these skull and crossbone and the name of every heavy metal band ever in existence stickered all over the back. And the guy opens up the door to pump gas in the pump in front of me. And you can just hear like the double bass pedal, the screaming, the guitars. And the guy like stumbles out of his car and is like, oh, you can see like this billow of smoke come out of his car, right? So he starts getting gas and he's got his radio blaring and I'm just like, okay, pump, pump, pump. You're looking at it, can you go any faster? And this kid comes over to me. Right as he comes over to me, I look at him, he looks at me, and he just begins to open his mouth. And I just say to him, hey man, not today. And he just says, all right. And he just turns and walks to the guy next to me. And the guy with the heavy metal blaring and just beating, and he's just barely staggering. You know, I don't even know if he was drunk or what, or if he just was high on, you know, heavy metal. I don't know, whatever. He starts telling him, and what this kid was is he was one of those guys that they sell those coupons for their uniforms. You know, if you buy this coupon book for $10, it helps me buy. And he was from Rialto High, and he was just trying to pay for his football uniform. So he goes over to this guy, and the guy turns his what? Turns his radio down. The kid tells him that, hey, I'm trying to buy my football uniform. And I'm just trying to sell these. And the guy's like, dude, totally. Oh, my gosh. He's like, hey, man, this guy's selling those. He's telling the guy and his friend, this guy's selling those ticket books, man. And he just whips out the money. He's like, dude, and gives him like a high five. And the kid goes on his way. And, man, the Holy Spirit nailed me. Just nailed me. And the Holy Spirit said to me, and you're the Christian. Oh, I mean, I just came undone. I was up in the mountains with a couple of guys from our church, and I'd confessed to them the story, and I just said, man, it just beat me up. But you know, it really kind of dawned on me, because in my own life, I've always thought myself to be a generous person. I've given everything I have is always up. My wife will tell you, if there's something in my house and I see that somebody needs it, I'll give it to them. Just whatever. She's like, Luke, that's yours. That's your favorite thing. Or that's your. And it's like, they need it. And I've always thought myself, I'm a generous person. And then the Holy Spirit convicts me of a selfish heart. How does this work? So I begin to read and I begin to study and begin to look at the Word of God. And I was reading in 2 Corinthians. And tonight I want to talk about the title of this message. And please don't shut off when you hear this, because I promise you, this is not about your money. Okay? Can you say, yes, Pastor Luke, I got you, okay? It's not about your money. It goes way far beyond that. The title of tonight's message is this, is Giving with a Purpose. Giving with a purpose. I wanted to call it gliving with a purpose. Giving and living, but anyways, we'll move on. And as I was reading the Bible in 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, Paul the Apostle is exhorting the church at Corinth about their gift. He's stirring them up for a collection, a gift, an offering that they've committed to. And he's kind of reminding them, hey, I'm coming into town. I want to exhort you. I want to remind you that you guys have committed to this. This is something that was on your hearts. You see, the thing about Corinthians is that they were a well-off church. They were on the higher scale of the economics of the churches of the day. And there were other churches that Paul uses the example. They were in deep poverty and they gave out of the abundance of their heart. And here he has to really kind of pull and pull it out of this church and remind them and just keep going at it. And he was speaking, and here I want to just take a look at two verses, and then we'll conclude at the end of the night with the last verse of 2 Corinthians in the 9th chapter, looking at verse number 6. Paul the Apostle says, but this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Now let's look at that for a moment, because you and I don't often talk. I mean, we all know the statement, what you sow, you reap. But let's look at that. Sowing is giving. Sowing is letting go. Sowing is planting. Sowing is taking something from your hand, from your possession, and putting it outside of your possession, whether it's a seed into the ground. That seed is no longer in your hand. It is no longer in your bank account. It is no longer in your pocket. It is now in the ground, subject to the mercy of the environment. So he says, if you sow, if you give, if you let go sparingly, you will reap or return or receive sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Verse number 7. So he says, so let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or out of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. Now tonight, I want to remind you one more time. This is not about your money. Take a big deep breath. I'm not going to try to milk it out of you tonight, all right? We're going to just talk about the heart, what He purposes in His heart. And you see, as the Holy Spirit convicted me, you're the Christian. You're the one that's generous. My response, my retort back was, God, I am generous. God, I've given guitars away. I've given equipment away. Half the video control room is my old equipment that I bought. You know, I look all around the church and there are so many different things that my wife and I, our first iPad, when the church wanted to use the little credit card swipe, we gave it to the church. We give everything away. God, how can you convict me of being selfish? How can you convict me of not giving? And God put some things in my heart. He said, it's not about giving when it looks good. It's not about giving to people you like. What about giving to the people that you will never see again? What about sowing a seed that you may never reap the harvest, that somebody else might reap? And it began to just unravel everything I had stood on because I thought that I was a generous person. And today I want to talk about giving with a purpose and looking at what you and I can do to give with a purpose. And you know, when I say it's not about your money, the reason I can say to you that it's not about your money, and even though Paul the Apostle is exhorting the church for a financial gift, giving, sowing goes so much beyond money. It goes so far beyond the dollar bills in our bank accounts. We have to learn to give our time, to give our efforts, to give of our emotions. Oftentimes we want to just close off, just shut down. I was on an airplane on Friday for 3 hours, and it was just so easy for me to put my headphones in and shut down. And sometimes we've got to learn that we've got to give of ourselves more than just money, more than just finances, more than just material or possessions. We've got to give of ourselves, give back to what God has given us, give to our time and our efforts and our emotions and whatever it might be that God is setting in our heart, a purpose, to learn how to give with a purpose. You've all heard about, you know, purpose-driven life and purpose-driven churches and purpose. We all have to have a reason, but God has put us on this place to sow into the kingdom of God so that we or that somebody else might reap. So today I want to just look at some things, quick things. I don't even want to spend a lot of time. I say that every time. About giving with a purpose. Just some things as I was studying, some things that I was looking at as God was speaking to my heart in my own life of how to improve the areas that need correction, to look at some things about giving with a purpose. And so I'm just going to give us three thoughts tonight on giving with a purpose. And they're not one, two, three, because it's not step one, step two, step three. It's three thoughts of giving with a purpose and how you and I can learn to live and to, some thoughts about it as to apply to our lives. And so today I want to just talk about giving with a purpose. I'll make that statement and we'll conclude that, or we'll finish the statement. So giving with a purpose, first thought for tonight, requires purpose. Giving with a purpose requires a purpose. That's like a totally obvious statement. Duh, Pastor Luke. But see, the thing is why give? What to give, when to give, how to give, what is it that we're going to give, what is it that we're going to do, how are we going to go about that? You see, if we don't set a purpose, if we don't set a reason, an example, if we don't set something aside in order to sow or to give, then guess what happens? We in our culture, we're consumers. Not just financially consumers. We consume everything. That's why when the latest gadget comes out and it saves us 4.7 seconds checking our email, we have to have it. Why? Because we want to consume as much time as we can doing other things. So if we don't get a purpose, or we don't establish a purpose in our lives as to what to do, as to how to apply, as to how to live, then we're going to go throughout our lives and we'll miss opportunities. If I don't set in myself, in my own heart, and say, God, I have a purpose. I have a budget, whether it's a financial budget, whether it's a time budget, whether it's an outreach budget, whatever it might be. God, I'm going to set this amount or this time or this effort aside, And I'm going to trust that you will give me the opportunity to seed it. But I'm going to place it in my heart with a purpose. What is purposed in your heart? As Paul exhorts the church, he says, I want to encourage you to give that which you had purposed in your heart. You had already thought about it, he says. You've already set it aside. You already talked about your wife or to your wife about it. You've already planned it out. Now that you've planned it out, follow through. And we've got to learn to set a purpose for giving. We had a missions conference a couple of weeks ago. One of the missionaries said that we don't know this, but the world looks at the American church and they say instead of America flowing with milk and honey, they say that the American church is about milk and money. Immature Christians that are only wrapped about money. We have got to have a purpose in our heart to give back, to sow into, to reach out, to do something for somebody else, to take that which is in our hands, whether it's our gifts, our talents, our abilities, our money, whatever it might be, and to say, I'm going to purpose this to do something, and I will reap bountifully because I will sow bountifully. We've got to set it aside to stop thinking so much about our own well-being and to start thinking about what's going on around us and how we can be a difference. If we don't set a purpose or make a plan, we'll never give anything. You'll never give anything. I have so many people that tell me, Pastor Luke, I want to get involved in the offering or the tithe as it comes by, but they show me their paycheck stubs. I can't do anything. Literally. Start somewhere because you'll look at the number and say, I can't do it. Start somewhere. Set a purpose. Put it in your heart and say, this is what I'm going to commit to. God will make a way. If it's your time, God will redeem your time because Paul says, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. You spend your time on you, or I spend my time on me, then I will reap sparingly my time. But if we sow our efforts, we sow our lives, we sow our time, we sow our money, guess what? We reap it bountifully when we give it bountifully. I tell you what, I know it's an oh me message, not an amen message. That's always what happens when you preach on the conviction of the Holy Spirit in your life. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Acts in the 20th chapter. You all right? Can you understand me?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Devil's a liar. Acts in the 20th chapter. Here we're going to read some statement from Paul. Paul's exhorting the church at Ephesus. Ephesus, of the seven churches in the book of Revelation, Ephesus is the church that was the church known as you've forgotten your first love. The church that had left or walked away from where they had originally come from. And to understand what Ephesus is, Ephesus to you and I would be like the mega church. Of the seven churches in the book of Revelation that Jesus writes letters to or speaks to, Ephesus is the largest church. Historians estimate that Ephesus had somewhere between 25,000 and 30,000 members in the church of Ephesus. And here Paul the Apostle is exhorting the church about some things in their life. In Acts in the 20th chapter, beginning in verse number 33, Acts 20, 33, Paul says, I have coveted no one's silver, gold, or apparel. Verse number 34, yes, you yourselves know that with these hands have provided for my necessities. I remember there was a story or a movie when I was a kid called The Neverending Story. Anybody remember that? I don't even understand it. I told my wife about it one day, and I was like, oh, it was the best movie I ever watched. And I was like, I don't get it. It didn't even make any sense. So I'm not even telling you that. But I remember there was this big rock guy, and he would just say, these hands used to be so strong. I could just imagine Paul as he's exhorting. He says, I want you yourselves to know that these hands, saying my hands, have provided for my necessities. And for those who were with me, Paul says, I provided for myself and for those around me. And he goes on in verse number 35. Check this out. And I have shown you in every way. Check that out. He said, I gave you an example for a reason. By laboring like this, that you must support the weak. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he said, it is more blessed than it is to more blessed to give than it is to receive. Paul the Apostle is telling the leaders and the elders of the church at Ephesus, I have labored for myself and for the betterment of those around me. I have provided for me and for others to show you for a purpose, to show you that you can take care of those who are around you. If I can do it, he says, you can do it. And then he quotes Jesus. Now, the interesting thing about this quote from Jesus is it's not found anywhere in the Gospels, but yet we find it in words of Christ in red, because the Bible tells us that Paul was given the dispensation of grace through Jesus Christ. It means that Paul had been caught up, Paul had conversed, had been taught, had been discipled by Jesus. And so here Paul is quoting one of the things that Christ may have very well taught him, that it is better to give than it is to receive. There is a purpose. There is something about giving that fulfills a man's spirit. We consume and consume and consume, and we're never full. Why? Because we weren't made to consume, we were made to give. We weren't made to be selfish, we were made to give to others. We make budgets in our lives. If you don't make a budget, you should. We plan if we're going to buy something, and if we're not, we set aside things that we're going to save to buy things. And now I'm encouraging us as a church to think in our hearts to set aside something in our lives to give, whether it's our time, whether it's our emotions, whether it's a relationship that you know needs to be encouraged. Start setting it aside. Maybe on a Friday, say, man, I know there's a relationship that somebody needs me and I need to do better on it. Then do something. Start putting a purpose in your heart to reach out to that person if that's the case. But put a purpose in your heart. Giving with a purpose starts with a purpose. One of the thoughts that the Holy Spirit was speaking to me on, giving with a purpose isn't about looks. Giving with a purpose is not about looks. Or how about this? Giving to look good. When we give, it looks good. But what about when no one's looking? What about giving when no one's looking? Since it's confession night, I'll give you another confession. All right, can we do that? So you know that I'm just as human as everybody else. We had our missions golf month. And in our missions golf tournament, we went around and everybody was playing. And you know, you pay to play in the golf tournament, and all the proceeds go towards missions and funding our missionaries around the world. And throughout the golf tournament, there were also small little fundraisers. And we get to this one hole, and there's this company that says, all right, there's a driver. And if you hit the ball the farthest or whatever it is, then you might win. And if you pay $20, you get to get a raffle ticket and win the driver. And all the proceeds to the $20 goes to your cause. I'm thinking, man, I already paid. So we're there. Funny thing I didn't know about it, I'll tell you afterwards, is the missionary that we're with pulls out a 20, boom, slaps it down. The guy, he pulls another one, boom, slaps it down. This guy, too, I'm covering that guy. He paid $40 to swing this golf club. Pastor Dan pulls out a $20 bill. Boom. All right. It's for our missions month. All eyes are on me. And I've made no secret about it. I don't like golf. Don't care. She's like, this is the best driver in the world. You might be able to win it. I'm like, who cares? If I win it, I'll never use it. But everybody was looking. So I pulled the $20 bill out of my wallet and was like, here you go. 100% guilty of giving to look good. Everybody was watching me. I didn't want to give it. If nobody was watching me, if I was golfing by myself, I would have said, hey, sorry about you. I don't have any cash, even though I had cash in my wallet. Funny thing is, my wife was right in front of us with her group of girls, and she told the lady, my husband's like El Cheapo. He ain't going to pay nothing. And when I told her that I paid, she was like, man, you got suckered into that one. But we do that. We give because it looks good. You know, you think about it, charity is cool. You know, oh, buy this pair of shoes and we'll give so much over here. Or buy this t-shirt that has the color red on it and we'll benefit these people over here. Or everything, every dollar you spend, we'll give 0.00001 cent to over here. Oh, but they're doing something. And so they do it to look good. not to do it. And you and I have got to learn that if we're going to be purposeful in giving and giving with a purpose in our life and to fulfill what God's desire for us, we got to learn to give when it doesn't look good. When not just because everybody's watching. Don't give the dollar bill to the guy because you see the pastor in your rear view window when you're at the stoplight. Oh man, pastor saw me. I better give him, you know, I better look like him. It's not about that. It's about giving when it doesn't look good, when nobody's looking. And that's what the Holy Spirit convicted me. I give. And I don't go and tout it and shout it, but I give to people I like. I give to people that I care about. But what about the people I don't know? What about the people I'll never know? What about the people I'll never meet? What about the fruit that I'll never see? We've got to learn to give. And if you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Matthew in the 6th chapter. Matthew chapter number 6. Matthew 6th chapter, Jesus is speaking. Verse number 2. It says, therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound the trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have the glory from men. Assuredly, I say to you, they will have their reward. Goes on in verse number 3, says, but when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret. For as your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. We like that. We live in a culture that says, I do good. I help my fellow mankind. So I give to someone and it says, give and we'll post it on Facebook for you. So-and-so just gave $10 to this or to that or whatever it might be. We dump buckets of ice on our head or we say we're not going to and we don't give the money anyways. And you see, we've got to learn as a church that it's not about the outward appearance. It's not about the glory of men. It's not even about receiving. I'll sow because Jesus asks me to sow. I'll do what God has asked me to do because God has asked me to do that, whether or not I receive the fruit or somebody else receives the fruit or reaps the harvest. Why? Because I know in my own life there has been times when I have reaped what somebody else has sown. Case in point, I took over young adults ministry. Pastor Jess and Pastor Dan sowed the seed, and I have been reaping what they have sowed. And you and I have gone through lives and we have seen things and we have reaped what others have sowed, but we've got to learn to sow when nobody's looking, when nobody cares, when nobody gives a hoot about it. Because that's what God says to do. To give with a purpose in our lives. Are you guys with me still? All right. It's a dismal clap, I know, because you're like, Pastor Luke, I should have gone to Calvary Chapel tonight, but it's all good. We love our brothers and sisters in Calvary Chapel. Giving with a purpose, last one for tonight. I told you I wasn't going to spend much time. One more point. Giving with a purpose, last one for tonight, is living for others. So giving with a purpose means setting a purpose. Giving with a purpose means not giving to look good. Giving with a purpose is living for others. It doesn't mean giving for others, living for others. You see, because giving with a purpose signifies an unselfish life. And an unselfish life means it's a life not about self. When it's not about self, therefore it's about others. And when we learn to give with a purpose, we learn that our life is about others, about making somebody else's life better. I mean, if you think all the way back to the very beginning, the golden rule, Jesus says to treat your neighbor as you would yourself. Why? Because it's not about how you treat yourself. It's about how you treat yourself. See, if everybody lived the golden rule, everybody'd be happy, right? Because we would all be living for others, but we get so wrapped up in our own selves. And I am just as guilty as everybody else. I'm the guiltiest person in here when it comes to living for self. And the Holy Spirit's just been working on me to be genuine, to not be fake, to not be phony, to not give because it looks good, but to be real about it. To really be about other people. To really care. When somebody says, will you pray for me, brother? To not say, I will, and forget. That's not what God's wanting us to do. That's why I say it's not about money. Maybe it's about taking 10 minutes out of your life to pray for somebody who's asked for it. Or who hasn't asked for it, but you know they need it. To give, to live for others. I remember when my wife and I, we bought a car many years ago. We were at the dealership, and it seems like every time we buy a car, it's at night, and it's always like as the dealership is closing. And so we were there, we were buying this car, it just had come out, we didn't know that. But we just liked it. It was a cool car. Didn't do any research on it. Just kind of, it was one of those emotional decisions. And I remember we were sitting there, and the salesman, now if you're a car salesman, I love you, I know you're not like this. But the car salesman was just like, hey man, listen, kind of leaning in the table, come here. I just want you to know, I got your back. It's you and me against the sales manager. Okay. So, well, what do you want to buy the car for? Well, we want to buy the car for this. Let me go talk to my manager. 15 minutes later. Oh, dude, he just beat me up, man. I tell you what, dude, I fought for you. I was arguing for you. He came back with this price. Oh, man, we want this. Let me go talk to my manager. 10 minutes later, comes back. Dude, this guy's cutthroat, man. He's just really, I'm working for you, man. Come on, work with me. How about this payment instead? I'm like, dude, I don't care about the payment. I want the price to be this. Okay, well, how about this? What if I throw, all right, throw this in and throw that in and throw this in over here, this package over here, and then tell me, all right, let me go talk. 20 minutes goes by. Guy's nowhere to be found. He's talking to his sales manager, so he says, right? He's out on the front of the dealership smoking a cigarette, waiting for me to sit it out. Oh, but it's you and me against the sales manager. It wasn't anything about that. He wasn't on my side, and from the very first moment, I knew that he wasn't on my side. And the very first thing when you step onto a car lot, that's why I say if you're a car salesman, we love you. But if you step onto a car lot and you see that guy walking down with the slacks and his t-shirt walking towards you, you know, you get the defense up. Why? Because you know they're not on your side. Unless you're in here. But you see, as Christians, the Holy Spirit convicted me at that gas station. Why? Because in my heart, I was acting like a car salesman. I was saying, I'm on your side. I'm the Christian. I'm the pastor. Oh, the Holy Spirit is upon me. But then at the same time, I'm saying, nah, I don't even want to hear your case. I don't even want to support your cause. It wasn't about the $10 that kid was asking for. It was about the heart. So the Holy Spirit says to me, man, it's not about you. It's not about your life. It's not about your money. It's not about how big of a house you have, what kind of a car you drive. It's about living life for others. The amazing thing is that some of the most impoverished places in the world have a concept of this, but us in America have such a hard time wrapping our fingers around this. That China is sending 35,000 missionaries a day into the world. And they can't even get a page of the Bible to read, and we have translations galore. And we sit at home and think about ourselves. We've got to learn, church, to give and to live for the betterment of somebody else. Because this world is dying. This world is going to hell in a handbasket. 57% of Americans, when surveyed around the world, says things are getting worse and they're not getting better. Obviously. We've seen things like placing military on borders of hostile countries, of placing trade embargoes on countries that want to do something. And we've seen over years and decades and decades and decades that has no effect. But what does is Jesus. But it takes somebody willing to say, I will live my life for somebody else. I will live my life for the betterment of somebody else, whether it's my family, whether it's somebody at my job, whether it's my friend that needs me and it's late at night and I don't want to answer the phone because I know that they're strung out or I know that they're drunk again or whatever it might be, I'm going to set a purpose in my life to live for somebody else that they might know Jesus. John, the 13th chapter. If you've got your Bibles, go with me there. John, the 13th chapter. John, chapter 13. This is a really amazing story, talking about living for others. John, chapter 13, beginning in verse number 12, Jesus has literally taken his clothes and taken his garments off that was that which identified him, and he's put on a robe or a towel. Got down on the ground with a bucket of water and he washed his disciples' feet. You got to understand that in the culture 2,000 years ago, feet, they didn't have closed-toed shoes. They didn't have Nikes and kicks, and it wasn't all about style. It wasn't about buying the newest and the coolest shoes, accessorizing. It was leather straps that you walked in the dirt and dung-filled road. Your feet were nasty. You think you got nasty feet now? You should have looked back 2,000 years ago. That's why it was such a disgrace to even talk about feet being under the feet, being set underneath somebody's foot. And here, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, on his knees, wrapped in a towel, begins to wash his disciples' feet. He takes the ultimate act of humility to his disciples, and he says to his disciples this very statement in John the 13th chapter. So when he'd washed their feet and he'd taken his garments, he sat down and he said to them, this is verse 12. He says, do you know what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, because I am. But if then your Lord and your teacher have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example set by Jesus, that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he sent greater than he who sent him. For if you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I remember there was a book I had read a long time ago called The Go-Giver. It was about a young salesman that was trying to figure out how to be successful, and he saw this successful man, and he began to interview and talk to his proteges and people that he had mentored and people that he walked, and they were all successful. And when it came down to meeting this man, the successful, this rich, this wealthy, famous man, the entire process was about giving somebody a genuine experience. That when you sold them something, they were more interested in the person on the phone selling it than they were the product. If you've ever bought something and somebody's gone out of their way for customer service, you know right off the bat, that's a company I'll support, that's a business that I'll buy from again, versus somebody that's taking your money, giving you a lousy product, and does not care about you. Because it's about being genuine. It's about investing. It's about allowing people to see who we really are, but that takes time, that takes a gift, that takes giving of ourselves for the betterment of somebody else. Jesus gives us the ultimate, or God gives us the ultimate example in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave. For God so loved the world that he gave. If God loved us so much to give his only begotten son, Jesus, if Jesus loved his disciples and us so much that he gave us an example to love others, we have got to learn as a church, as Americans, or in whatever walk of life we're in, to give to others around us. Because this life that we live is not for us. This life that we live is for Christ. And I love this. We were there in 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. Go back to 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. Go back to 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. You're like, praise the Lord, he's wrapping it up. All good. 2 Corinthians, in the 9th chapter. We had read, I say that he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. So let each one give as he's purposed in his heart. It's time to set purposes in our heart. What is the budget that we're going to allow? Whether it be time, whether it be effort, whether it be emotion, whether it be finances, whatever it is, set something aside and prepare. Not grudgingly or out of necessity or for looks. We could add that in our own thoughts as we discussed today. For God loves a cheerful giver. And I love this. Verse number 8. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for what? Every good work. For every good work. I'm going to conclude with this thought. My daddy taught me this, and I have seen it all my life. You can't outgive God. You can't outgive God. It may have cost you something. It may have been valuable to you. You may not feel like it. You may not want to. But when we give that which costs us, that which we have purposed in our heart, God is able to make all grace abound towards us, that we would have all sufficiency in all things and have an abundance for every good work. Why? Because you can't outgive God. Elijah, come on up. Tonight, before we conclude this message, I just want to take a moment. I want to pray because the Holy Spirit is on my heart. There are areas that I know I need to be generous in. There are areas I know in my life that I need to set a purpose and fulfill and not to forget on Sunday night. And if you're in this place and you say, man, Pastor Luke, there are some things in my life, there are some areas in my life that I know I need to give. I need to be a purposeful giver, to live and to give with a purpose. I'm just going to ask you to stand and let's just pray that God would make all grace abound towards us. Let's pray that God would give us the opportunity to exercise and to use that which He's called us and gifted us to do. And let's believe that God is going to do something, not just in our own lives, but in this church. Not just in this church, but in this city. Not just in this city, but in this inland empire. Not just in this inland empire, but in this country. Not just in this country, but all around the world. But it starts with each and every one of us doing something for the kingdom of God. Amen. So would you just raise your hands to the Lord? Let's just pray today. Father, I just come before you. Lord, we just come with our hearts open, our hearts prepared. And Lord, I ask that just as your Holy Spirit spoke to me on that day at the gas station, that your Holy Spirit right now would speak to each and every one of us in this room on things in our lives that we need to look at, things in our lives that we need to pay attention to, areas of our lives that when it comes to giving, when it comes to living for others, that we would need to address. And Holy Spirit, we thank you that you would give us all wisdom that we need. Give us direction as we lay aside, Lord, that which cost me. As David says, I won't give that which cost me nothing. Lord, I pray as we lay it aside, your word says that he who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. So Lord, I pray that as we give, as we set a purpose in our hearts to be a generous church, to be a generous people, to be a people that is not about milk and honey, but milk and money, but milk and honey. To send to a lost and dying world, whether that dying world is around the world or around the oceans or right around the corner. God, I pray that you would just impart into us that generosity, that divine drive, that we would say, there's an opportunity, I'm going to do it. There's an opportunity, I'm going to do it. There's an opportunity, I'm going to do it. And Lord, I pray that as we sow, as we give, as we pour out ourselves, as we make ourselves available, Lord, I pray that your word, your promises would be true, that you would give us grace. Lord, that it would abound towards us, that we would have everything that we need and every abundance for good works. Lord, I pray that you would redeem the time. If it's late at night, Lord, I pray that you would redeem the sleep. If it's dollar bills, I pray that you would redeem that. And Lord, I pray that we would each reap where we haven't sown. And Lord, I pray that we would sow and somebody else would reap the benefits. Because God, it's not about us, it's about others. And right now, I just want to take a moment. There's somebody in your life, you know, you need to set a purpose. Maybe it's a phone call. Maybe it's a text message. Maybe it's just a, hey man, I'm praying for you. But I just want to take a moment, and I want to just ask each and every one of you for the next 20 seconds to pray for that person, to pray for that individual, to pray for that which is set into your heart. Let's just pray for that person right now, that God would give us the opportunity to show us what we can do to be better givers. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for the ultimate example of your love and your desire to live for those other than yourself by giving Jesus Christ for us. So Lord, we look to you. We look to Jesus, who says, do you know what I have done? I have washed the feet. I have laid on the cross, given myself. Lord, as Jesus' promise to us says, if you do these and you follow what I say, you will be blessed. I pray for blessing in this house. Blessing so that we could bless more. Reaping so that we could sow more. Giving so we can give more. Lord, Lord, I pray that we would see the fruits of our labors, Lord, that we would reap bountifully that which we have sown in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. You can sit down. I'm going to do it a little bit differently. I don't want to teach about giving and then just receive the offering. Just a minute. Before we go any further, I just want to give you the opportunity to ensure and examine your life. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time, and I want to ask you a very important question. I want to ask you, just give you your complete attention. It's so important that you get this. The question I want to ask is that if you were to leave today and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, would you open your eyes in heaven? Would you open your eyes in hell? It's a relatively simple question. Nobody's going to know that answer except you and God, not your spouse, not your friend, not the person you're sitting next to. Only you and God. You say, Pastor Luke, well, you know, I'm excited about heaven. I'm not quite sure about hell or whatever it might be. I only believe that all is good. Listen, let me tell you something. God loves you and I enough to tell us about it in the Bible. Jesus loved us enough to teach about it in the Word of God. Heaven is a real place. Hell is a real place. The Bible says that when a man dies, we've got two options, heaven or hell. That's why I said options, because you see, we've been given the gift. It's just a matter of receiving that gift. So if you say, well, I'm going to go to heaven, let me ask you this. What makes you so sure? Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you hope you're going to get to heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you want to, because you desire to. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you think you're going to get to heaven, like you've got the most positive outlook on life, you're going to get to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get to heaven because you want to, because you hope so, because you think so? You can't find that in the Bible. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church, because you were baptized or christened as a baby, because your godparents made a vow for you when you were unable to even comprehend the promise that they were making? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're going to get into heaven for that? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you give yourself a title of Christian. Well, my parents told me I was a Christian all my life. I've always just said, I live in America. America, you know, we're Christians. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you call yourself a Christian that you're going to get into heaven? You know, that's like me going down to the airsoft store. I could buy all the army gear I want. I could even buy a replica army gun. But did you know that I'm not a member of the armed forces, even though I might look the part, even though I might proclaim to be, even though I might have all the drab and the garb on? Did you know that no point am I really a part of the armed forces? Why? Because it's not about looking the part. It's not about giving yourself the title. There's more to it than that. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church, here you are today, that God's after your gold star attendance record. Well, man, you attended church so many times, you got in. Did you know that it doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible how many times you attend church? If you got a good attendance record, you're going to get to heaven? You can't get to heaven because you attend church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person? Well, Pastor Luke, I give to those charitable organizations. Pastor Luke, I give to the Red Cross or the relief effort or whatever it might be. I don't speed on the freeway. I've never robbed the 7-Eleven. I do more good than I do bad. Good people go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible do you find that? Can you find that good people go to heaven? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that our good deeds, our good works are like filthy rags to God's righteousness. You see, none of us are good enough on the outside. It has nothing to do with what we do on the outside that allows us into heaven. Why? Because the standard of entrance into heaven is perfection. It's God's heaven. It's God's way. But the Bible tells us that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means each and every one of us by birth have already fallen short of God's standard. So how do we get there? Well, it's God's heaven. It's God's way. Jesus is that way. Jesus says this. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father except through Him. So how do we get to heaven? Well, let's talk about this. In the book of John, I quoted John 3:16, the same conversation that John 3:16, Jesus is speaking to a man by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus asks, what must a man do to inherit eternal life, to enter into the kingdom of God? And Jesus says this to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, you must be born again. What does that mean? Let's define that. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the heart of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. You see, it's not about your carnal knowledge of who God is or who Jesus is. You know the reality is I know who Barack Obama is, but I do not know Barack Obama. The Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know and believe in Jesus, but they're not on their way to heaven. It's not about your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. It's not about rehearsing or inciting, reciting traditions. It's about a wholehearted relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me show it to you in the Bible. Jesus Christ is speaking to the church. I referenced it earlier today in the book of Revelation. Writing a letter to the church, Jesus says these words to the church. He says, when I come back, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. He goes on, he says, because if I find you lukewarm, Jesus says, I will vomit you from my mouth. Whoa, shocking statement from Jesus. And what he's saying is that lukewarm Christians are going to be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God, be counted as waste, worthless in the kingdom of God. What does lukewarm mean? Let's define that. Lukewarm simply means in terms of your relationship with Jesus, a little bit up, you got your highs, a little bit down, you got your lows. A little bit in, full commitment, a little bit out, doing my own thing. You got one foot in the church, one foot in the world, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Maybe you got a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, token prayer. Every once again, occasional church attendance. Doing your own thing instead of God's thing. You're not wholehearted for God, but you're not wholehearted against God. Let me love you enough, respect you enough, let me honor you enough to tell you the truth tonight that you're not going to make it into heaven because you think. You're not going to get to heaven because your parents told you. You're not going to get to heaven because of your good deeds. You're not going to get to heaven because of your carnal knowledge. It's all or nothing. And God forgive us in the American church for watering it down for hundreds of years so that you and I would believe something that's not true. The reality is God gave everything for you and I through Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, and in return, he wants our all. Jesus, on a beaten, bloody cross, died for our sins, hung naked for the world to see, for our sin and our shame, and in return, he wants all of our heart and wants all of our life. So today, I want to give you that opportunity in this auditorium tonight. Just a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and the count to three, I'm going to go three. Smack my hands together real loud like that. That wasn't really loud. And what I want to do, I'm going to give you the opportunity. I'm going to ask you, when I count to three, I'm going to go three. I'm going to go, bang! Smack my hands. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, Pastor Luke, I want to give Jesus my heart. Pastor Luke, I want to give him my life. Pastor Luke, today I want to get saved. You say, Pastor Luke, I don't think I can raise my hand. If I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. Somebody's going to see me. I don't know if I can do that. I don't know if I can face that kind of embarrassment tonight. Let me encourage you for a moment. I'm not going to embarrass you, but wouldn't it be better, even if you were embarrassed, to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm, welcome, and loving place like the church? You see, the decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. He's done everything he could by giving Jesus Christ his most valuable possession to die on the cross. And now the Bible says the gift of God is eternal salvation. It's a gift that you and I have got to choose to receive. And the first steps is acknowledging that we want to do that. You see, Jesus says these words. Jesus says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But he goes on and he says, but if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father. The decision is yours. God loved you enough to give you a free will choice. He could have designed us all to be robots to follow his will, but he says, I love them enough to let them choose for themselves the decision that they want. It's your choice today. Nobody's going to make you. Nobody's going to force you. Your choice to receive or to reject the gift of eternal salvation. Today it starts. Who should raise their hand? If you've never given God your heart, you've never given God your life. In just a moment, if that's you, when I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. In just a moment, who should raise their hand if you've never, or if you're not sure? Maybe you did this at a Harvest Crusader. Or you did this in a youth group or something like that, but you never really followed through with it. Maybe you're just, you say, man, Pastor Luke, I don't know where I stand. If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Finally, who should raise your hand? If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, you've been more about tradition and ceremony. You've been more about a following a guideline rather than a wholehearted marriage commitment to Jesus. Today, let's get this the opportunity that you go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place. Listen, we got to get a right understanding of God. God's not there in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to slap you over the head because of all the things that you've done. He's not like a little kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass waiting to burn you up. He loves you. Loves you so much he gave Jesus. And today, is your day. You've had doctor's appointments and dentist appointments. You've even had DMV appointments. Well, tonight is a divine appointment between you and God. You're here for a purpose, and it starts by making the decision. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. I'm going to smack my hand on my Bible. That'll make a louder bang. If that's you, whether you're in the front row, the back row, you guys in the family room with your kids, if that's you, I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. We'll go forward together from there. I'm going to count to three. This is your moment. If you're at home watching online, this is your moment. Nothing's stopping you right now from making this decision, but it starts right now. All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, this is your moment. This is your time. I'm going to count to three. Get ready. Pop your hand up, and I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Seven wise people. I see you guys. Now you can't raise his hand for him. Eight, nine. All right. You got your hands up on your own, my man? All right. Nine wise people. I see you guys back there. 10, I see you right there. I got you, my friend, in the back. 10 wise people. 11, I see you, my friend. 12, I see you right there. 13, I see you. Say, man, I wonder if I should. 14, I see that hand in the back. See, 15, got you, my friend. 15 wise people. Anybody else in this place, say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on, this is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else in this place tonight? 15 wise people. Well, hey, let's glorify God and praise God for 15 wonderful and wise decisions. All right. All 15 of you, if you raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you say, man, I should have done that. Listen, I said this is the first step. Now it's time to follow up that decision. It's time to accept and receive Jesus Christ, and we're going to do that together. We're going to pray. So in just a moment, we're all going to stand. If you raise your hand, if you're in the family room, ushers will come and help you grab your stuff, and you grab your kids, whatever it is. If you're right here, grab your sweater, your coat, your purse, your Bible, a friend. If you need a friend, if you came with somebody, say, hey, man, go with me. Or you see somebody that raised their hand, say, hey, man, I'll go with you. And as we all stand, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, come get in the aisle and come meet me right here. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So come on, let's all stand together. Let's welcome them as they come. If that's you in this place today, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, come meet me right here today.
Lord, I give you my heart. I'll give you my soul. I'll live for you alone.
Every
breath that I take.
If you raise your hand and you're serious about this, come on.
Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart. I'll give you my soul.
Praise God. There are some of you in this place that you raised your hand, but you're not here. Listen, I told you I love you enough to tell you the truth. If you want somebody to blow smoke at you and tickle your ears, great. You're not going to get away with that here at the church. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You start. You get saved by making Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. We want to help you. We want to pray for you. If you're going to start the very first moments of your relationship with God in rebellion here, what are you going to do outside of the walls? So I want to encourage you, we're going to give you a minute. And if that's you in this place and you raise your hand, or you didn't raise your hand, but you know you need to be up here, I want you to get out of your seat. I want you to get out of your chair. Come on, if you're serious about this today, come up here and let's change destinies together. Let's sing that song one more time.
Because Lord, I give you my heart. I'll give you my soul. And I'll live. And every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me.
All right. Come on, guys. Perfect. This is it. Listen, I love you guys enough. I tell you the truth, and I said it's all about being real. I'm not a car salesman. When I say I love you enough to be a fool for you, I do. I'll hold up the whole service just so you guys would come, because you're important. You're important to God, and this is an important moment for you. So I want to share something with you guys today. Hey, first of all, you get to smile. Why? Because you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. You're going to get born again today. Amen. That's cool. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here in the blue sweater right here? His name is Reverend Antonio. I call him T. He's a cool guy. All right, Tony's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm as weird as it gets. I have two different color socks on. Pastor Dan wears funky socks. I just don't even wear the same ones. I'm as weird as it gets, all right? He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by asking Jesus to come into your life and to be the Lord and Savior, or to be the leader of your life. He's going to give you some free information that you walk out of this place, you're going to say, what do I do? Where do I go now? We're going to point you in the right direction. And the last thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. You got the word of God. You made the decision here. We want to invite you to come back and sit with somebody. They'll buy you a cup of coffee or a soda or something like that. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the word of God. You know, you go to the gym, you get a personal trainer to make sure you get strong and you're using that equipment the right way. We want to give you a spiritual personal trainer, somebody that will sit with you, that will meet with you, that will teach you some things about the word of God for a couple of weeks to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from today. So if you would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Antonio. Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.